All right. Quick review, and we'll pick up and see. Lois was, she wasn't feeling well, said she had to come here because she thought I might get to chapter 12. I said, we should, but one never knows, but we're going to try. Real fast, let me pick up some and remind you of some of what I've said about chapter 10, and we'll pick up where we were and go on. In Romans chapter 10, verses 5 to 13, that section, it ends with an emphasis on the fact that salvation is available to all who will believe in the Lord Jesus, all who will call on the name of the Lord. And then in verses 14 to 21 of chapter 10, Paul says that though relatively few Jews embraced the gospel, it was not because they didn't hear the message. That wasn't the reason that relatively few embraced the gospel. The voices and the words of Christian preachers had spread far and wide, so Jews everywhere, they were exposed to the message. And this Jewish hearing of the gospel, the message to which these Jews everywhere had been exposed, it was that hearing was not the hearing of a message that they couldn't understand. Okay, it wasn't the case. It's a message they can't understand, so they can't justifiably plead lack of comprehension as an excuse for their failure to believe. Their lack of comprehension was willful. It was willful. God appealed to them, but they were stubborn and obstinate. That's what he says, all day I held out my hands to you. Chapter 11, verses 1 to 10, Paul says that God didn't reject his people because, as he said in chapter 9, verses 6 and 7, and in a number of other places, Israel is not defined by mere physical descent. Israel as a whole, Israel of the flesh, did not obtain the righteous status that it sought, but those who submitted to the righteousness of faith in Christ, true Israel, they did obtain it. The rest, the unbelieving Israelites, they were strengthened in their unbelief so as to serve the divine purpose that he then explains in chapter 11, verses 11 to 16. Now there, in those verses, 11, verses 11 to 16, we're told that God hardened unbelieving Israel in its rejection of Christ, the effect of which was to invigorate the Gentile mission and thus to increase the conversion of Gentiles. And you can see Jewish rejection of the gospel. You can see it serving that purpose as an impetus to the Gentile mission. You can see it, for example, in Acts 13, verses 45 to 47, Acts 18, 5 and 6, Acts 19, 9 and 10. You can see that concept of Jewish rejection of the gospel serving as an impetus to the Gentile mission. And the more intense their rejection of the gospel, the more it was judged, you see, to be a poor use of time to seek to convert the Jews, so greater attention was devoted to the Gentiles. And this increased Gentile conversion that resulted from this Jewish hardening, that was in turn intended to maximize the Jewish remnant. You see, that subset of physical Israel that embraced the gospel, so it was intended to maximize the Jewish remnant by provoking the Jews to faith through jealousy, through their desire to share in the life that's being received by the Gentiles through faith. So, I mean, this is, as we get down, as I said before, we'll get down to 11. That's what causes Paul just to break out into this doxology. But if the Jews, he says in 11 to 16, if the Jews trespassing against the command to believe in Jesus, if their rejection of the gospel means blessings for the Gentiles, well, then their fulfilling of that command by accepting the gospel will mean additional blessings, which I take and see as it will mean the enlargement of the Jewish remnant on top of the Gentiles who had come to faith. Now in 11, 17 to 24, so we went through all that before. I just always like to quickly get to where we are. And then 11, 17 to 24, Paul explains that the alienation of Jews, it doesn't mean that Gentiles are superior, and that's where I want to pick back up. He says in 11, 17 to 24, but if some of the branches were broken off, and you, though being a wild olive shoot, he's talking to the Gentiles, were grafted in among them and became a sharer in the rich root of the olive tree, do not boast over the branches. But if you do boast, remember that you do not support the root, but the root supports you. You will say then, branches were broken off so that I may be grafted in. Quite right. They were broken off because of unbelief, and you stand by faith. Do not think haughty thoughts, but be afraid. For if God did not spare the natural branches, perhaps neither will he spare you. There's a textual issue with perhaps. That's why I put it in brackets. Notice then the kindness and the severity of God. Severity toward those who fell because God's kindness. Severity toward those who fell, but God's kindness toward you if you continue in his kindness. Otherwise, you also will be cut off. And those also, if they do not continue in unbelief, will be grafted in. For God is able to graft them in again. For if you were cut from a naturally wild olive tree, and contrary to nature, were grafted into a cultivated olive tree, even more will these, the natural branches, be grafted into their own olive tree. Okay, Paul says here, Paul says in this section, 17 to 24, it's true that some Jews were removed from the people of God by their rejection of Christ, and some Gentiles were grafted in. Some Gentiles were added to the people of God by their acceptance of Christ. But the Gentile must not consider his people, his race, superior in God's sight because of that. See, he's trying to get them to not look down on these Jewish Christians or others because he says, listen, that's not how you need to read this. This shouldn't be something that puffs you up against other people. That's not the case at all. After all, the church is Jewish at its root. That's what he says, you know, you don't support the root supports you. The church is Jewish at its root. The apostles, the early Christians are what? They are part of true Israel. They are Jews who had the faith of Abraham. Well, why do they have the faith of Abraham? Because they believe God's testimony about the Lord Jesus Christ. So in that they showed we are physical descendants of Abraham who are not only physical descendants, but we also share the faith of Abraham. We are true Jews, not simply physical Israel. We are true Israel. And so that's the root. That's the root of the church. Gentiles are grafted into that. Okay, so Paul is wanting them to see that. You see, moreover, the differing circumstances of Jews and Gentiles, it's not about race. It's not about the people group. It is about faith. So why would you be puffed up in terms of your race versus the Jew? Because the critical thing, the differing circumstances, is about faith. If the Gentile does not continue in belief, he'll be cut off. That's what Paul says. If they don't continue in belief, he'll be cut off just as was the unbelieving Jew. They're cut off what? Because of unbelief. You're in why? Because of belief. If you don't continue to believe, what? You're out of the people of God. And so he tells them, listen, it's not about race, it's about faith. If the unbelieving Jew does not continue in unbelief, he will be what? Grafted back in. So you have Jews who have rejected the Messiah, and he says they're cut off from the people of God because of their unbelief. But if they don't continue in their unbelief, they will be grafted in. He says, after all, you're a wild olive thing, and you olive tree, and you're grafted in to the cultivated tree. If God does that on the basis of your faith, don't you think he will take the natural branches from the cultivated tree that have been separated and graft them back in if they don't continue in unbelief? So he's saying, listen, this is something that's about faith. And then he says in 11, 25 to 32, for I do not want you, brothers, to be ignorant of this mystery, lest you be wise in your own estimation, that a hardening in part has come to Israel until the fulfilling of the Gentiles happens, and in this way all Israel will be saved, just as it is written, the deliverer will come from Zion, he will turn on godliness from Jacob, and this will be my covenant with them when I take away their sins. With reference to the gospel, they are enemies on account of you. But with reference to the selection, they're beloved on account of the fathers, for the gifts and the call of God are irrevocable. For as you formerly were disobedient to God, but have now received mercy by their disobedience, so also they have now been disobedient for your mercy, in order that they may also now receive mercy. For God imprisoned everyone in disobedience so that he might have mercy on everyone. All right, now many scholars see this as a reference, this text that I'm looking at here. They see this as a reference to a large-scale turning of Jews to the Christian faith at the end of time. Many people take that understanding and see it that way, that what is being spoken of here is that at the end, before Christ returns, there will be a large-scale conversion of Jews. But I don't think that's right. Okay, so you at least are tuned in that many people would say, I'm wrong. All right, but I don't think that's right. See, as I said in relation to Romans chapter 9, verses 6 through 13, if the promises were not addressed to unbelieving Israel, and Paul says there that they were not, then God's faithfulness is not called into question by unbelieving Jews who do not inherit salvation, because the promise was not to them. So unbelieving Jews who do not inherit salvation, that doesn't bring into question God's faithfulness. And on the other hand, if the promises were addressed to physical Israelites regardless of faith, well then an end time conversion of the last generation of Israelites, that wouldn't answer the charge of God's unfaithfulness for all preceding generations. You see, if the issue is his faithfulness, Paul says, no, the promise doesn't go to unbelieving Israel. It goes to true Israel. That's what he says in chapter 9. Now you say, well, if it's not that way, well, then how would it answer the charge of God's unfaithfulness to say all of these Israelites were lost except the final generation? That doesn't seem to me to be responsive to the criticism that Paul is addressing. So I think Paul is saying, look, the promises were not addressed to Israel. And Paul says that a hardening was upon part of Israel until and so that the Gentiles fulfilling their accepting of Christ happens. Now that's my translation. That's one of the meanings of that word that's given in the standard Greek lexicon, Bauer, Danker, Hart, and Gingrich. And see, through this process, all Israel will be saved. In other words, there's a three-step process that I see Paul giving in Romans chapter 10 and 11. And it involves a Jewish hardening. So you have Israel is here. Some believe, the apostles in the early church. Those who don't believe, there is this hardening. And this serves here to increase Gentile faith. It serves as an impetus to the Gentile mission. That then creates Jewish jealousy, which leads to an enlargement of the Jewish remnant, to the inclusion within true Israel of those Jews who were originally resistant but who were foreseen by God to believe. They were foreseen as part of true Israel. So you've got this, it's part of God's evangelism strategy, as I said last week. Now without that process, some would not have been included within Israel. And thus true Israel defined in terms of God, not all of true Israel defined in terms of God's foreknowledge would have been saved. That's what I see Paul talking about. He says, listen, God hardens in part the unbelieving Jewish group. And he hardens them in part, and that then serves as an impetus to accelerated Gentile mission. As more and more Gentiles come to faith, that then serves as a cause of jealousy for this originally unbelieving group, and then these, some of those, then come to faith as a result of that, enlarging the Jewish remnant, enlarging true Israel. So God is out here picking up everybody. You see, this is His purpose and His plan of picking up everybody. And this Gentile fulfilling means that the gospel had spread. You see, it had spread to the nations. The way I see this Gentile fulfilling, it means that the gospel had spread to the nations. The church had been established among the Gentiles to an extent great enough to produce Jewish jealousy, to have the Gentile effect. Okay, it had this fulfilling had gone, that it had become extensive enough among Gentiles to produce Jewish jealousy as part of this evangelism strategy to pull out the remainder of those Jews who initially had rejected and who will now come and express their faith in Christ and then be part of true Israel that God has seen. See, that this was already in operation. I think this is already in operation, this fulfilling is happening, because Paul says in verse 14, he says that he's hoping some Jews, to save some Jews through jealousy. So it seems like this Gentile effect has already, in other words, that the extent of Gentile acceptance has already been great enough to generate the jealousy that will go ahead and serve as this evangelistic purpose of pulling out those from the unbelieving Jews. So, because he says he hopes that, he says there in 14 that he's hoping to save some Jews through jealousy. And it's also that this is already ongoing. It seems to me is indicated by the fact verse 31 speaks of the Jews now receiving mercy. Let me see if I need to click this. Okay, now receiving mercy. There's a textual issue about now is now original. But most would agree that it is. All right. I've kind of summarized this already, but I want to say it again. In other words, the hardening of the Jews who initially rejected the gospel was temporary. And it was done to invigorate the Gentile mission so as to produce Jewish jealousy, which in turn served to help bring some of those initial rejectors who were once hardened to conversion. See, with the purpose of the hardening achieved through this fulfilling of the Gentiles, that is, with the Gentile acceptance reaching the extent sufficient to produce Jewish jealousy, it was lifted. Now, he doesn't say that. But if I'm right that he's already anticipating that this is going on, then the hardening is lifted so that some who were once hardened in their unbelief come to faith. But that number remains relatively few. Okay, and you can see that still some, like when Paul in Acts chapter 28, verse 22 and 28, which occurs years later during Paul's first Roman imprisonment, you see that some Jews accept the message and other Jews reject it. And though that rejection, that still contributes to Gentile mission, the hardening that he talks about when he says that God had hardened that part of unbelieving Israel, he had hardened unbelieving Israel, that was used to accelerate the Gentile mission to the point sufficient to create Jewish jealousy, which as I see it occurred in the first century. You see, so we have physical Israel, some accept, unbelieving Israel, hardening, stimulates the Gentile mission. It happens so that we now get critical mass sufficient to create Jewish jealousy that then pulls from this initial unbelieving remnant those who come to faith. Okay? And so that's what I think Paul is talking about here. Now he says, with reference to the gospel, these hardened Jews who ultimately convert through the Gentile effect, he says they're enemies for the benefit of Gentiles. Well, you can see that, right? In the way he's looking at it, he says, well, they're enemies because that stimulated and was an impetus to Gentile mission. So he says they were enemies on behalf of Gentiles, but with reference to the election, they are beloved on account of the Father. See, when God called the patriarchs, he promised to bless them and their faithful descendants, and his gift and his call are irrevocable. So he says here, they're enemies on account of you, but he says here that with reference to the election, They're beloved on account of the patriarchs. God handed, he says, both groups, Jews and Gentiles, over to disobedience. Meaning that he hardened them, or as he says with the Gentiles in Romans 1, he let them go their own way. He gave them over. See, to their desires and impulses. He gave them over. Okay, so God handed over both groups, Jews and Gentiles, to disobedience, meaning he hardens them or gives them over to their own devices as part of his way of bestowing mercy on both groups. I mean, it's just mind-blowing. He says the disobedient Gentiles, they receive mercy through the disobedience of the Jews. Right? That was what served as an impetus to the Gentile mission. So they receive mercy through the disobedience of the Gentile Jews. And this happened that the disobedient Jews might also receive mercy through the once disobedient Gentiles by the jealousy effect. You see, so it's like, now, if you've even followed what I'm driving at, it comes as no shock that Paul winds up saying in 33 to 36, oh, the depth. Now, sometimes we just think it just drops out of nowhere. It doesn't drop out of nowhere. It drops out of 9, 10, and 11. And Paul is just like going, oh. He says, oh, the depth of the riches and the wisdom and the knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and incomprehensible his ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord? Or who has been his counselor? Or who has given an advice to him that it will be repaid to him? For all things are from him and through him and to him. To him be the glory forever. Amen. Do you see this? Because Paul has just said this absolutely mind-blowing complexity of what God has been doing, that God has revealed to him. And then he just sits here and goes, man, who can trace out the mind of God? Who would have looked and said, oh, yes, I can see this. Let me write this down here. I see this right clearly. You carry the two. No! God sits here and says, you do, just leave it to me. I'm at work. And Paul, when he's given this revelation, he just explodes in this wonder of God's working. It just blows Paul's mind, and he breaks out in this emotional expression of praise and adoration. God's wisdom and his ways of working, they simply are beyond our comprehension. Now, we don't like that. You know, you want to say, listen, there's nothing I can't grasp, nothing I can't comprehend. Paul's just putting his toe in the water here. And you think you're going to wrap your mind around God and his working, and you're going to get frustrated when you're just going to have to give it up. You have to give it up. You have to understand that he is God. You see, that's the thing. See, all we can do as creatures is receive what he reveals, and we bow before him in awe. He's not on trial. You know that story about the museum? They have all these great Renaissance masters, you know, Rembrandt, all these people in there. You know, somebody comes to you and, hey, look, I'm not impressed. And the curator says to this person, well, these paintings aren't on trial. You are. You see, that's not up for debate. You see, and this is how this is. God's not on trial. See, to him be the glory forever. Amen. And that's what Paul concludes with. Now, we are going to get to Romans chapter 12, you see. Hey, here we go. All right, she's happy. Okay, chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. Therefore, I urge you, brothers, through the compassions of God, to present your bodies as a sacrifice, living, holy, and acceptable to God, which is your understanding service. And do not be conformed to this age, but be transformed by the renewal of the mind, so that you may ascertain what is the will of God, the thing that is good and acceptable and perfect. In light of the mercies or compassions of God, Paul urges them to present to God the sacrifice of a life that is dedicated to God and pleasing to Him. This is what we are to do. The mercies of God refers to all that Paul has written about God's working that he has just summarized in chapter 11, verses 30 to 32. And in light of those mercies, he urges the saints, he urges all Christians, he urges us to present our bodies as a sacrifice, meaning that we are willingly to offer in devotion to God consecrated lives, lives in which the sinful practices of the body have been put to death by the power of the Spirit, as he said in chapter 8, verse 13. You see, when he says, offer your bodies as a sacrifice, and in 8:13 he said, you are to put to death the misdeeds, the practices of the body by the power of the Spirit, we are to offer to God consecrated lives where we take and use our body, which is how we are in this world. We take and use our body in ways that are righteous and holy and good and pure, and we glorify God in what we do with our bodies. Where we go, what we look at, how we act, what we engage in. You see, that's what he's saying. In light of these mercies, in light of these compassions, this is what we are to do. We're to use our bodies. We are to direct the activity of our bodies in righteousness as an expression of gratitude and submission to God. This is not optional. This is not legalism. This is Bible. This is how we are to live. You see, this is how we are to live. Paul says that this kind of living, this figurative sacrifice, is our understanding or reasonable service. It is the appropriate, proper, right, fitting response of creatures who are rational or reasoning. It is an appropriate and right and fitting response of rational and reasoning creatures to the God of mercy. There is something grossly hideous, grossly inappropriate for rational creatures not to give God his due as the Almighty. There's something unfitting about it. For people who are in the image of God, who are rational, reasoning beings, not to give God his due as the Almighty. You know that text in Isaiah chapter 1, verses 2 and 3. Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth, for the Lord has spoken. Children have I reared and brought up, but they have rebelled against me. The ox knows its owner. He says, the dumb ox knows its owner. The ox knows its owner and the donkey its master's crib, but Israel does not know. My people do not understand. There is something warped and twisted when reasoning rash. He says, look, I got an ox. It knows what's going on. It knows its master. It knows its owner. And you are in the image of God a rational, reasoning being. And you owe me in that regard. See, it is grossly wrong and twisted for us not to give God what he is due as the Almighty. Deuteronomy 10, 12, and 13. And now, Israel, what does the Lord your God require of you but to fear the Lord your God, to walk in all his ways, to love him, to serve the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, and to keep his commandments and statutes of the Lord, and to keep the commandments and statutes of the Lord which I'm commanding you today for your good. You see, this is what Paul is saying. Listen, he says, in view of all these things, in light of these mercies, this is how you're to be. You are to live consecrated lives. Lives where you have put to death the misdeeds of the body by the power of the Spirit. You're to live this way as an offering and an honor, an expression of God, to God, of your gratitude. an expression of your acceptance of who He is. And this is how we are to live. Now, there are translation issues. I'll just say this as kind of a long footnote. There are translation issues in both the words of the phrase that I've translated, understanding service. Okay, you have translation issues there. The first word in that phrase, two words there. The first word may mean spiritual, rational, appropriate, or reasonable. And the second word may mean either service or more specifically worship. Okay, now many commentators and many translators, they understand this second word, latreia, here in this verse. They understand it as worship. But as Everett Harrison says in his commentary, worship may be too restricted a rendering in this context. And he favors service here because it covers the entire range of the Christian's life and activity. And that's how I see it. Now, latreia is, in fact, that second word is translated service in the King James, the English Revised, the American Standard, the New King James, the New English Translation, as a footnote in the English Standard Version. So it's not exotic, eccentric, okay, to render it that way. The standard Greek lexicon, it suggests for this phrase, thoughtful service, okay, in Romans 12:1. Now, the phrase is rendered reasonable service in the King James, English Revised, New King James, New English Translation, rational service in the footnote in the ESV, and spiritual service in the American Standard. But even if one takes the idea and says, okay, no, I think I'm going to opt for latreia to mean worship here. Even if one takes it, I think it's a mistake, as is sometimes done, to jump from that idea to read Paul as saying that there's no longer a place for more specific or direct acts of worship carried out at certain times and locations. Even if you accept that the proper rendering of latreia in this context is worship, Paul simply means that, as was true in the Old Testament, that this more specific, this more direct worship that takes place at certain times and locations, that must be practiced as part of a wider worship or service that embraces the whole of a Christian's life. In other words, he's not saying there is no place for direct and specific acts of worship at times and places. He's saying that a predicate for all such worship to be acceptable to God is a life lived in submission to Him. You cannot live like a non-Christian. You cannot be living with your boyfriend or girlfriend. You cannot be getting drunk. You cannot be doing all of these other things and living like a non-Christian and then come together with the community of saints to worship and think that's pleasing to God. I mean, look what Amos says. You find it all through the Bible. You can't play God for a chump. Treat Him like He's nothing in your life, and then think that when I come in a cultic setting and offer worship, this specific direct worship to God, that somehow He's pleased and satisfied with that. No. Okay? Absolutely not. All right? Let me read to you what Cranfield says in his commentary. He says, Paul's use of the word latreia implies that the true worship which God desires embraces the whole of the Christian's life from day to day. It implies that any cultic worship which is not accompanied by obedience in the ordinary affairs of life must be regarded as false worship, unacceptable to God. But it would be quite unjustifiable. Oh, there's another hyphen, so I didn't solve the problem I thought I had. It would be quite unjustifiable to argue that the logical implication of Paul's use of latreia here is that no room is left for a Christian cultic worship carried out at particular times and in particular places. Another one. Provided that such worship in the narrower sense is always practiced as part of the wider worship embracing the whole of the Christian's living and is not thought of as something acceptable to God apart from obedience of life. There is nothing here to deny its place in the life of the faithful. And I think this is important. Michael Thompson, who's a lecturer in New Testament at Cambridge, he says, The apostle urges a way of life as a whole, identified as a right-minded worship or service. In doing so, he no doubt expands our understanding of what kind of worship God values. The true worship is inseparably connected with Christian behavior in general. But it is a logical fallacy to conclude from this text that he redefines worship as, or reduces worship to, Christian ethics. And we have people that suggest that. Well, all of life is worship. So there's no room, there's no idea of specific and direct acts of worship. Everything's worship. You see? And so basically reduce worship to Christian ethics any more than Hosea's commendation of love and knowledge over sacrificial offerings proves that the prophet was calling for an absolute end to form a ritual and to form and ritual. You see, so that's not the idea. And I think that's important. Now, some people, they fear, you see, they fear that giving the assembly, giving our gathering together on the Lord's day, they fear that giving the assembly any kind of special significance, that in doing that, you see, that we detract from the importance of daily faithful living, and thus we encourage a kind of ritualistic devotion. In other words, that if you say that there is something special and distinctive about worship in this narrower sense, about our gathering and do it, well, what you're doing is you're fueling people's idea that it doesn't matter how you live. And I don't think it should be an either-or thing. I think we can catch the grandeur of our gatherings and see that there is in fact something distinctive and special and amazing that occurs as we gather as the body of Christ, redeemed people, and we express our devotion to God in prayer and song, and as we submit to Him as He speaks to us through His Word. We don't just sit here, we submit to His Word. That's worshiping Him. You see, so we wind up saying, I think we can see that without falling prey to the idea that God cares only about the assembly. He doesn't care only about the assembly. That's the whole idea of seeing that your life lived in submission to God is the predicate for acceptable worship. You see, it is the background. It is how that happens, that we come and worship God acceptably because we live for Him in our lives. Okay, so I think, but that's a concern that I run across, and maybe I don't have enough patience for it, but there you have it. All right. So we're not molded. Paul says here, we're not molded. Let me see, do I need to? Yes, let me get back here. Paul says that we're not molded to fit the godlessness of this age. I had occasion recently to tell somebody, I said, listen, I don't get my morals from Hollywood. You see? The fact that you take polls and stuff, and, well, that doesn't matter to me. You see? We serve God. I'm not going to be conformed and molded to the godlessness of this age just because somebody will think I'm a troglodyte if I don't embrace what they want me to embrace. Okay, not going to happen. Shouldn't happen. And so he says, look, that we're not to be molded to fit the godlessness of this age, but rather we're to be transformed by a spiritual reprogramming of our minds so that we can ascertain the good, pleasing, and perfect will of God by which we are to live. Though this word that's used here for ascertain, it usually has the sense of test or examine or approve. It shades into the meaning ascertain or discern, which is how it's translated here in the New English Bible, New Jerusalem Bible, New Revised Standard, and the Christian Standard Bible. That's why I think that's the right sense of it here. As James Dunn says, what is in view in Romans chapter 12, verse 2, is the capacity of forming the correct Christian ethical judgment at each given moment. See, this reprogramming that is taking place in our lives as Christians, this reprogramming that's taking place is a lifelong process. In the vernacular, we constantly will be getting our minds right. It's a lifelong process of getting our mind right. The more we think as God wants us to think,
the greater insight we'll have into how God wants us to live, and we'll be able to comprehend more clearly and deeply God's moral direction. Now, part of this, a crucial part of this, I'm convinced, is we have to spend time in the Word of God. You know, I'm convinced that, you know, the Church of Christ in a bygone day, we were known as people of the book. See, really people who really studied and thought and meditated and knew the Bible. I don't think that's true anymore. Now, maybe I'm just, you know, sheltered. But I don't think that's true anymore. And what I'm saying to you is if you want to get your mind oriented and transformed by the Spirit, we must breathe in God's perspective. We must breathe in God's vision, God's side of the story, God's truth, because we have constant voices telling us from every television program, every movie, every book, telling us this is truth, this is how you're to see things, this is the way. And if you don't draw on the well that is the revelation of God, how are you to keep your mind right? That is part of how the Spirit transforms us. He uses this revelation to transform us so that we have our God glasses on. You see? That's how, and so we keep drinking deeply of that word, deeply of that word. Well, how do you see? Well, I'm trying to see here. I'm trying to see how God sees. Well, don't you care how the latest director in Hollywood sees it? No, I don't. I want to see how God sees it. And so I just think it's very, very, now how do we get people to do that? That's the thing. I don't know. That's not been a problem in my life. I have other problems. That hadn't been one. Okay, but how do we get people and stimulate people that they, it's a big book, it takes time. You have to breathe it in. You have to discipline yourself. You must get God's perspective. You see, and I think it's just very, very important, and that's what I see at work here. Did I miss the second bell? Okay, well, I'm stopping here because I know as soon as I start on 12, 3 through 8, it'll ring. Thank you for coming.